Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of War Stories by Oliver North, narrated by Joel Leffert, with an introduction narrated by the author. This book is copyrighted 2003 by Oliver North and the Fox News Network. This recording is copyrighted 2004 by Recorded Books. During Operation Iraqi Freedom, Oliver North and his cameraman, Griff Jenkins, were embedded with Army and Marine units for the Fox News Network. This is his eyewitness account of the heroism, courage, and unflagging patriotism of the American military forces who ended Saddam Hussein's rule in Iraq. And now, War Stories.
Preface. Headquarters, 3rd Battalion, 66th Armored Regiment, 4th Infantry Division, west of Tikrit, Iraq, Saturday, 26 April, 2003, 0100 hours, local. The satellite telephone vibrating against my chest awakens me with a start after less than a half hour of sleep. Many years ago, as a Marine officer, I learned to nap with a radio handset tucked into my helmet up against my ear so that an urgent call on the command net would rouse me. Since being in Iraq, I've done a similar thing, catching snatches of sleep with an Iridium satellite phone placed inside my flak jacket, up against my chest, so that I won't miss a message from the Fox News Channel foreign desk. These calls have been coming nearly nightly for 2 months, alerting us to prepare for a live hit with a Fox News Channel host or correspondent in New York or Washington. But tonight's communication is different. The message is both welcome and bittersweet. "Come on home," said Brian Knobloch, the head of Fox News Channel Foreign Operations. I awakened Griff Jenkins, my very brave and resourceful field producer and cameraman. He arises smiling and starts packing our camera equipment and satellite broadcast gear in the dark. We're the last Fox News Channel field team still embedded in Operation Iraqi Freedom. Our cameras are full of sand. The portable generator has been gone for days, left for dead beside an Iraqi airstrip. Our man-packed satellite gear has been cooked by the sun, soaked in the Tigris, and bathed in dirt. The rest of our equipment is just about shot, and so are we. Yet, leaving these soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines we've been covering since before the start of this second Iraqi war isn't easy. We've been eating the same meals, breathing the same dust, sharing their fears, frustrations, and euphoria, and enjoying their protection for too long not to feel awkward at leaving them. We're going home. They are not. Well before dawn breaks across the Tigris, while Griff sorts through our gear, I go into the Battalion Tactical Operations Center, the TOC, to plug in my laptop computer and enter these final notes. A last sit-rep. Situation report from the war that we've been covering since before it started on March 20th. At a computer and radio console inside the TOC, a watch officer called a battle captain in this U.S. Armor unit hands me a clipboard holding a printout of the daily air tasking order. "Pick your flight and make your reservation early to avoid the rush," he says with a smile. He points to a flight scheduled for shortly after first light, an H-60 Blackhawk, with space for two passengers, headed for Baghdad. He puts Griff and me on the flight manifest and says, "We'll miss you guys. The Colonel, Lieutenant Colonel Larry Jackson, believes the toughest part of this war is still ahead of us." Unfortunately, he's right. The 4th Infantry Division, the 4th ID in military shorthand, is also known as the Digital Division because of all of its high-tech equipment. These 17,000 highly trained and motivated soldiers were supposed to have entered the fight through Turkey, charging south toward Baghdad from bases that had been carefully negotiated by Pentagon planners months before the shooting began. But in the convoluted course between NATO headquarters outside Brussels, the UN in New York, and the State Department in Washington, the Turks said no, and the plan fell off track. Instead of fighting their way into Iraq, the 4th ID had to come in weeks later through Kuwait and then travel by convoy to Saddam's hometown over ground seized by other soldiers and Marines who'd come before them. Many of the troopers in this prized unit regard their belated arrival as a terrible insult foisted upon them by the State Department, They held a war and Colin Powell, the SOB, made us late, volunteered one 4th ID officer. Other officers and senior non-commissioned officers are much less concerned about the action that they've missed and more anxious about what lies ahead. They've seen low-intensity combat before and know it can be just as deadly and demanding as any other form of armed conflict. This is just another phase in what's going to be a long war, says Lieutenant Colonel Larry Pepper Jackson, commanding officer of 3rd Battalion, 66th Armor. My mission is to hunt down HVTs, that's high-value targets, the U.S. military's euphemism for terrorist chieftains and enemy leaders. Find any evidence of weapons of mass destruction, protect the oil refinery down the road, restore essential infrastructure, that's electricity, water, sanitation, and medical services, provide security for the local population, and protect my own force from attack by terrorists, Ba'athists, and criminals. I've got plenty to do, but I've got great troops to get the job done. Great troops. I've been hearing those words for most of my adult life. I used to say that, and mean it, about the Marines that I led in war and in peace. I've also heard those words a lot since arriving in Kuwait before the start of the war. Now, having lived with the troops and seen them fight, it's apparent that they really are just that, great troops. I have a standard of comparison. I first saw the carnage of combat as a rifle platoon commander in Vietnam. And I've been an eyewitness to the valor and horror of war in Lebanon, Central America, Afghanistan, and Israel. In my experience, there have never been brighter, better trained, better equipped soldiers, sailors, airmen, guardsmen, and Marines than those now serving in Iraq. And the credit for this goes to the staff non-commissioned officers, chiefs, and junior officers who held the military together during the budget cuts, social engineering, fruitless deployments, and lack of training in the 1990s. In the combat arms, infantry, artillery, armor, airborne, reconnaissance, and special operations, they're all male since current law forbids putting women into combat units. That doesn't mean that young American women aren't in harm's way. Women serve in combat support assignments in every branch of our armed forces. That means that young American women like Army PFC Jessica Lynch, arguably the most famous female in recent U.S. military history, can easily find themselves under fire. Corporal Amanda Honus of HMM 268 qualified as combat aircrew in Iraq. And during one terrible night over Baghdad in a CH-46, I watched her skillfully employ a 50-caliber machine gun to dispatch the enemy troops who were firing on us. Given our current force structure, with women constituting almost 14% of the Army, and 6% of the Marine Corps, it's fair to say that this war could not have been fought without the fairer sex. Without taking anything away from women like the Army's Jessica Lynch or the Marines' Amanda Honus and the role they play in our military, it's still important to recognize that nearly all those on the ground who took the fight to Saddam are males. And while there's no typical soldier or Marine, it is possible to describe the average young American who carries a weapon into battle. He's a volunteer, 19.6 years old, making him about 6 months older than his grandfather was when drafted to serve in World War II in Korea, or his father was when conscripted for Vietnam. He isn't old enough to buy a beer, and if he were back home in the States, we'd call him a boy. But because he's in uniform fighting a war, we call him a soldier, sailor, airman, or Marine. This young man in uniform was probably a team sports athlete in high school. He graduated somewhere in the middle of the pack, making him better educated than any prior generation in our military. Unlike many of his peers, he's never drawn an unemployment check, and he does never want to. He had a job in high school in order to buy a car that was already about 10 years old. He bought the car to take his high school sweetheart out on dates, and when he left for a war halfway around the world, she promised to wait for him. Unfortunately, unless they were married before his departure, and about 15 to 25% of those who live near their military bases are, she's likely to be dating another guy by the time this Iraqi war veteran returns home. When our trooper does get back, he'll call her new beau a wimp, and she'll know he's right. About 3 times a week, he grabs a few minutes to write home. When the mailbag arrives by helicopter, he's hoping to get a letter from his girl and his mom, though he'll never admit to the latter. If his girl or his mom sends him a care package with disposable razors, shaving cream, toothpaste, M&Ms, beef jerky, toilet paper, and baby wipes, he'll share them with his whole squad and be a hero for a day. He has a short haircut and tight muscles and wears a 4-pound Kevlar helmet and an 18-pound flak jacket to work. He can march all day in 100-degree heat with a 60-pound pack on his back. This young man in uniform knows how to use every weapon in his unit and can field strip and reassemble his own weapon in less than a minute, in the dark. Over here he's gone weeks without bathing, but cleans his weapon every day. His rifle company gunny, or sergeant first class in the Army, has been in combat before, yet this is the first time he and his lieutenant have been shot at. Under fire, he obeys orders instantly, but if asked, he'll always have an opinion on how to do something better. Often, he'll be right. He's been taught chemistry, physics, and ballistics, and can navigate with a map and compass, but prefers the GPS he bought at the base exchange. When he catches a break, which isn't often, he reads paperback books. He loves thrillers. Before joining the military, he couldn't be bludgeoned into picking up his room, doing his laundry, or washing the dishes. But now, he's remarkably self-sufficient. He prepares his own meals, washes and mends his own clothes, digs his own foxhole and latrine, and keeps his feet dry and his canteens full. The kid who once wouldn't share a candy bar with his little brother will now offer his last drop of water to a wounded comrade, give his only ration to a hungry Iraqi child, and split his ammo with a mate in a firefight. He's been trained to use his body like a weapon, and his weapon as if it were part of his body, and he uses either to take a life or save one, because that's his job. The youngster used to stay in the sack until noon, now exists on just 3 or 4 hours of sleep a day. When he comes home to the United States, he'll be on average 12 pounds lighter than when he left. By now, he's already had more responsibility and seen more suffering and death than most of his civilian contemporaries will see in their entire lifetimes. He's learned a whole new vernacular of foreign-sounding words. It's not Iraqi Arabic, but military shorthand. He uses words like CONUS, H-hour, Zulu time, incoming, snafu, and FUBAR that mean nothing to most civilians. He's been told that grown men don't cry, but he's wept unashamedly in public over a fallen friend, because he knows heroes aren't defined by the way they die, but how they live. And though he can now take profanity to the level of an art form, it's also likely that he has a Bible in his rucksack and he isn't afraid to be seen reading it. He's proud to be serving his country, reveres his commander-in-chief, and knows that he is respected in return. While he's modest about his own courage and military prowess, he's absolutely certain that his is the toughest unit in the U.S. Armed Forces. When he gets home, he won't talk much about the horror of war and probably won't have post-traumatic stress disorder, but he will want more fresh milk, salads, and homemade cookies than anyone ever thought possible. And when he goes to a ball game or some formal event, he'll resent those who carelessly ignore the national anthem when it's played or don't join in when the Pledge of Allegiance is recited. He'll put his hand over his heart, gaze at the American flag, and sing or recite proudly and loudly. These are the young Americans who beat the butcher of Baghdad. Their skill and daring, discipline and endurance are without parallel in the world today. Good troops, indeed. They're a credit to their parents and to this nation. This book is for and about them.
Introduction. Reality Television. After Action Report. USS Abraham Lincoln. Pacific Ocean, vicinity 131 degrees west, 30 degrees north. Thursday, 1st of May, 2003. 0900 hours local. Shortly after my return to the United States from Iraq, President George W. Bush, a former F-104 pilot wearing a military flight suit, roared onto the flight deck of the U.S. aircraft carrier USS Abraham Lincoln
in a U.S. Navy W-3B Viking. Shortly after landing, he welcomed the crew home and congratulated them for serving with distinction in the war against terrorism and during Operation Iraqi Freedom. Later, wearing a business suit, he addressed the nation from the flight deck. The president's remarks had barely been transcribed before the criticism began. Some in the media described the trip to the carrier as a publicity stunt and castigated the White House for an extravagant waste of tax dollars. White House spokesman Ari Fleischer tried to defend the trip by pointing out that the cost of the flight in the Viking would have been nearly the same as the president taking a helicopter, but that a helicopter would have taken longer and would have been more hazardous, and, according to the Secret Service, less secure. Fleischer's defense was ignored. Then Senator Robert Byrd of West Virginia, the so-called Dean of the Senate, rose to berate the Commander-in-Chief, saying, "To me, it is an affront to the Americans killed or injured in Iraq for the president to exploit the trappings of war for the momentary spectacle of a speech." The controversy, and particularly Senator Byrd's divisive statements, sparked a flood of emails from those I had come to know in Iraq and scores of other men and women of the military. Many soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines felt that the criticism of President Bush was an effort to divide them from their commander-in-chief, a man they may or may not have voted for, but whom, in the aftermath of September 11th, they widely admired. Though West Virginia has more citizens serving in the armed forces per capita than any other state, Senator Byrd persisted in his attack, prompting a deluge of mail into my office, much of it highly derogatory to Senator Byrd, some of it intended to remind Americans that the good senator had once been a member of the Ku Klux Klan. One such missive began with, "Senator Byrd, who in his salad days spent more time in white sheets than in camouflage uniforms, just doesn't get it." Another characterized the senator's rant as Byrd droppings. Yet the media lapped up Byrd's remarks and raced around Washington seeking more outrageous partisanship to feed the hungry maw of the non-stop news cycle. Forgotten in all of this were the 5,500 officers and sailors of the USS Abraham Lincoln. In late December 2002, they had been headed home to San Diego through the Indian Ocean after a six-month deployment in support of Operation Enduring Freedom in Afghanistan. The crew was looking forward to seeing their wives and children, who were eagerly awaiting their arrival in Southern California. Then came their new orders: turn around and head north, back up the Persian Gulf, and prepare for war. For the next 4 months, the crew of the Abraham Lincoln served without leave, carrying out their orders. They had already launched almost 600 combat sorties in support of Operation Enduring Freedom in Afghanistan, and nearly 1,000 more in support of Operation Southern Watch, enforcing the no-fly zones over Iraq. Then they handled 1,558 combat sorties supporting the Marines, soldiers, and special operations teams of Operation Iraqi Freedom. And they did it all, more than 3,000 sorties, without casualties. When their mission was completed, they had been deployed for 290 consecutive days and had traveled more than 100,000 miles, the equivalent of circling the globe 4 times. None of this mattered to the president's ardent critics, who also chose to ignore the extraordinary compliment President Bush had paid to the crew of Honest Abe. By landing on a moving aircraft carrier at sea, an extraordinarily difficult feat, the commander-in-chief was offering the crew of the Abraham Lincoln the ultimate accolade. He put his life in the hands of a Navy pilot and the crew of the carrier, never doubting that they would bring him in safely. All of this was a rude awakening to those of us who had just returned from the harsh realities of Iraq. There, brave men and women were serving in harm's way, in great personal danger. Even when there was little danger, the requirements of duty and the conditions under which they served were difficult at best and downright horrible at worst. But being back home, hearing the Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of the United States being described as a desk-bound president who assumes the garb of a warrior for the purposes of a speech, and accused of flamboyant showmanship and self-congratulatory gestures by a U.S. senator, made many of the troops ask, "What am I doing here?" Before the story waned, Congressman Henry Waxman, citing clear political overtones, was calling for a congressional investigation of the president's flight. But most of the sailors and Marines aboard the USS Abraham Lincoln wondered about the political motivations of the president's detractors. Meanwhile, others in Congress began calling for a regime change at the White House. Among the troops who communicated with me in the weeks right after I returned home, the strident partisanship of the attacks on President Bush was topic number one. What we didn't know then was that this was just the opening volley. It was about to get a whole lot worse. After Action Report, Washington, D.C., Friday, 12th of May, 2003, 0900 hours local. After the vicious assault on the president, it should probably have been expected that those who were embedded with the troops, and who reported good things about them, would be the next targets. It seems that almost all of us who lived with the troops came away favorably impressed. I've spent much of my life in the military, and have concluded, based on how these warriors performed under combat, that the soldiers, sailors, airmen, guardsmen, and Marines serving in Iraq are without parallel. There has never been a brighter, better trained, better equipped group of people under arms than those who responded to our country's call in this war. No military force in history has ever gone so far, so fast, with so few casualties as this group of young Americans. I said that repeatedly during my time with the troops, and I know no other way to put it. It seemed fairly self-evident to nearly every embedded correspondent, and certainly was to me. And I don't pretend to be nearly as observant as a professional journalist. I didn't learn journalism at the Naval Academy, but I did learn to recognize courage, competence, commitment, and compassion, all qualities that these youngsters have in abundance. I did not expect the ire of the Fourth Estate for what their colleagues had said, that these young American men and women of the armed forces really are remarkable troops. But that's exactly what happened. Apparently, I and some others who were embedded lived with the troops too long, got too close to them. We lost objectivity and became flag-waving advocates, as was reported in one weekly news magazine. Time magazine's James Poniewozik, among others, scolded us for covering the war from the American perspective, branding us as biased for the way we reported the swift victory over the vaunted Republican Guard troops and Saddam's fedayeen. Harper's Magazine publisher, John MacArthur, citing the way embedded reporters covered Marine Corporal Edward Chin scaling the statue of Saddam and momentarily draping the huge black metal sculpture with Old Glory, accused not only the embedded media, but also the U.S. military of being propagandistic for the Bush re-election campaign. The reality is considerably different. Most of us who were embedded with the troops simply allowed the young Americans doing the fighting to tell their story. They said how proud they were to help liberate a repressed people. They spoke openly about being honored to be in the service of their country, and they showed modesty and restraint in talking about their own courage and military prowess. We didn't make this stuff up. The troops said it in their own words. These words from our troops may have shocked and surprised the editors of the New York Times, the Washington Post, Harper's, and Time. Just because a young American goes live on Fox News Channel and tells America that he believes his country is doing something right doesn't mean those of us who held the microphones and cameras have lost our objectivity. The media elites may not like hearing young Americans raised on a steady diet of political correctness, inane sitcoms, and video games talk about virtue, values, and valor, but that's the way they are. That's reality television. Here is an eyewitness account of the war in Iraq, not as the negative mainstream media and defamatory politicians would like you to see it, but as it actually happened, and often from the perspective of those who should know, because they were there, the men and women of the 1st Marine Expeditionary Force and the U.S. Army's 4th Infantry Division. Chapter 1. The Road to Hell. Operation Iraqi Freedom, Situation Report Number 1. Kuwait International Airport, Kuwait. Thursday, 6th of March, 2003. 23:30 hours, local. "Are you here as a member of the armed forces or as a member of the media?" asks the neatly uniformed but unsmiling Kuwaiti immigration official. "I'm here to cover the war for Fox News Channel," I reply. "Does it matter?" "Oh, yes," he says, trying to be both firm and polite at the same time. "If you are here with the media, you are limited to a 60-day stay, and you must be escorted by the Ministry of Information. If you are here with the American military, there is no time limit, and your visa will be stamped by the Ministry of Defense." "Well, this time it's the media," I respond, hoping that my honesty won't precipitate an inordinate delay in passing through the immigration and customs bureaucracy. "It's my first mistake on this trip, and entitles me to a 2-hour wait for an absent civil servant from the Ministry of Information." I had been through this same airport in November 2001, traveling back to Bahrain after covering the U.S. Air Force pilots flying over Afghanistan from Kuwaiti bases during Operation Enduring Freedom. Then I had been asked only for my passport and U.S. military identity card, and had been amused when a Kuwaiti customs official dryly observed, "It's nice to see that you are traveling on your own passport these days, Colonel North." Back in the 1980s, when I served as the United States government's counter-terrorism coordinator, I had been issued a U.S. passport with the name William P. Good next to my picture, and an Irish passport under the name of John Clancy. Whether the Kuwaiti official had remembered or a computer warning entry had alerted him to the fact, I had been reassured that by 2001, my prior use of alias travel documents wasn't reason enough to have me miss my flight. Tonight, it's a different problem. Without the appropriate Ministry of Information official on hand, no American media representatives are being allowed to enter Kuwait. The people of the tiny oil-rich emirate may be grateful to us for liberating their country in 1991, but that gratitude doesn't extend to members of America's Fourth Estate. The Kuwaitis aren't alone in their distrust of the American media. Most of our own military have a justifiable concern that the decision to embed reporters with U.S. units preparing for combat is unwise at best and a formula for disaster at worst. Many senior NCOs, non-commissioned officers, and officers can still vividly recall how the media turned on them in Vietnam. And since then, the less they have to do with the press, the better off they feel. "Think about it," a Marine colonel challenged me before I left the States. "If you were a battalion commander in combat, would you want a guy with a TV camera and a live mic walking around talking to privates and PFCs?" I had to admit to him that I wouldn't. "Do you remember the bogus CNN tailwind story?" an Army brigadier had responded when I asked him about his attitude toward having print and broadcast journalists traveling with frontline units and filing uncensored reports. "They, CNN and Time magazine, created that story out of whole cloth," he said, of the discredited and now admittedly false account that U.S. forces had used sarin, a nerve agent, in Vietnam in an attempt to gas American deserters. CNN first broadcast the story on June 7, 1998, only to retract it a month later, but I could sense that the wound was still raw. The brigadier shook his head and muttered, "There wasn't a shred of truth to Tailwind, but we're still answering the mail on that one. Just imagine the stories of atrocities, needless casualties, and bungled ops your pals in the media will spin from Iraq." These thoughts are much on my mind when the appropriate Kuwaiti official finally arrives and carefully peruses a long printout of approved media representatives. He finds my name on the list and with a flourish slams a hand stamp with purple ink on my passport, my visa, and a special media pass. As I walk out of the airport's customs and immigration restricted area, my field producer, Griff Jenkins, who flew to Kuwait several days earlier, greets me. I'm introduced to another Ministry of Information official who hands me a sheaf of papers explaining in several languages the rules of behavior for guest journalists, along with suggestions for a historical perspective on the region. As he drops us at the Marriott Hotel in downtown Kuwait City, he politely says, "Welcome back to Kuwait, Colonel North." Then, almost as an afterthought, he adds with a smile, "Please remember, correspondents aren't allowed to be armed." As we enter the hotel, dawn is just beginning to insinuate itself over the Persian Gulf. In a matter of minutes, the sun will be casting long shadows over the confluence of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, 120 miles to the northwest, in Iraq. Operation Iraqi Freedom, Situation Report Number 2. Ad Dawha Port Facility, Kuwait. Saturday, 8th of March, 2003. 1300 hours local. It is clear that the people here are worried. Ali, our driver, lent to Fox News Channel by the Ministry of Information to facilitate getting around the emirate, talks about little other than the imminent onset of hostilities. "It has to start soon," he opines. "There is no more space in the hotels here for reporters." He's right about that. In the Marriott, where the Fox News Channel Bureau has been set up, every room is occupied. It's the same in every other hotel in Kuwait. The Sheraton and the Intercontinental, just down the street from where Fox has its headquarters, have now taken on the appearance of network affiliates. Commercial Humvees, brand new 4x4 Ford Excursions, and GMC Suburbans with satellite dishes secured to their roof racks line every hotel parking lot. Many of them have TV emblazoned on their sides with duct tape. Some are even painted to match the military's flat desert tan. There are so many U.S. and European reporters, producers, writers, and technicians here that the streets outside every hostelry look like those of a major American city. As we approach the port area, Ali has to negotiate a series of military checkpoints. At each, Kuwaiti soldiers and Interior Ministry police inspect the inside and outside of the vehicle, using a mirror on a long wand to peer beneath the van. Ali produces his license and a yellow travel pass for the vehicle, and Griff and I hand over our passports, visas, press credentials, and a sheet of paper signed by the Ministry of Information official at our hotel, giving us permission to visit the port area. Ali endures this ritual three times without complaint before we actually arrive at our destination. "Yesterday they caught an Iraqi spy trying to get into the port," he says. Then he adds with a sigh, "It's going to be this way until you finish Saddam. I hope you go all the way and do it right this time." I ignore Ali's iteration of the frequently repeated Kuwaiti jibe at the United States for leaving Saddam in power at the end of the 1990-1991 Gulf War. Instead, I press him on the apprehension of this Iraqi spy. I had not heard about the arrest, and it's precisely the kind of story we want Fox to break, if we can confirm it. But Ali claims he doesn't know any more about the spy and changes the subject. "Were you afraid during the missile attack last night?" he asks, referring to the sirens that had gone off all over Kuwait City at about 1 a.m. "Not especially," I answer, instantly concerned that my reply sounded foolhardy. The fact is, I had grabbed my network-issued gas mask and lightweight chemical suit and raced for the Fox rooftop studio, not out of bravado, but because I knew that it was a safer place to be than the hotel basement bomb shelter if the Iraqis were firing chemical-laden Scud missiles at the city. "I understand that one of your new Patriot missiles shot it down before it hit. Is that true?" Ali asks. "That's the way it sounded to me," I reply, recalling the deep boom off to the north of the city. "According to the news this morning, it dropped into Khalj al-Kuwait," I add, referring to the bay just north of the capital, and falling into the trap of providing a recycled story I'd heard on the radio earlier in the day. "But is that what really happened?" Ali presses, once again reflecting the uncertainty he and his countrymen are feeling as the Allied buildup in Kuwait enters its fourth month. "I don't know what really happened, Ali," I say, as sympathetically as possible. "He had told me the day before how he and his family had to flee when the Iraqis invaded in 1990, and how anxious his little girl was over what might happen to them. In fact, I looked for a report from Central Command that morning. Something that would explain the sirens and the loud explosion. There was nothing." As we arrive at the main gate of the port, an enormous military convoy is departing through the exit, about 50 yards away. There are at least 50 HETs, 40-wheeled heavy equipment transporters, loaded with desert-painted M1 Abrams tanks and Bradley fighting vehicles, forming up on the highway. Military police in Humvees with 50-caliber machine guns mounted on top scurry in and among the HETs like gnats swarming around a herd of cattle. As I reach for my camera to shoot some footage of the convoy forming up, Ali holds up his hand and says politely but firmly, "Don't do that here, Oliver. If you get caught, we will not only not make it inside, we probably won't make it back to Kuwait City tonight either." I put the camera back in its bag and nod to Ali. He works for the Kuwaiti government and doesn't want to lose his job. Griff Jenkins and I have coerced Ali into driving us to Kuwait's commercial port at the mouth of the Persian Gulf so that we can shop for some necessities at the Allied Forces military exchange aboard the base. I'm the only one with a U.S. military identity card, and we have a long shopping list from the other two Fox teams that will be going into Iraq with U.S. units. Ali waits in the van while Griff and I head into the enormous air-conditioned warehouse that serves as the exchange. Inside the cavernous building is a well-ordered mob scene. At least 1,000 American and Allied soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines are queued up at more than 12 checkout lines. Nearly all of them are garbed in desert camouflage, though the varying patterns adopted by the different American, British, and Australian service branches lend a distinctively international air to the scene. Nation of origin or branch of service doesn't seem to matter when it comes to what they are buying. Each shopping basket seems identical, and nearly every one contains packages of disposable razors, shaving cream, scores of socks, bungee cords, CDs, cameras, film, videotape, batteries of every size and description, flashlights, sunscreen, insect repellent, sunglasses, foot powder, large packages of toilet paper, containers of baby wipes, and candies, particularly M&Ms and Skittles, which supposedly won't melt in the oppressive heat, and brown, green, and tan T-shirts. Many shoppers also have GPS receivers, purchased in the electronics department of the exchange, an area that appears to be stocked with as many choices as any warehouse discount store back in the States. Griff and I pick up the items on our list and join one of the slow-moving checkout lines. It's not long before I am recognized, and there is a rush to take photos and get autographs. I'm soon out of these signature cards that Fox gives me for this purpose, and I end up using a laundry marker to sign desert camouflage hats, helmets, and flak jackets. I begin to hope that I never meet the supply sergeants in these units, for fear they will bill me for all the headgear that never gets turned in. "What unit are you going to be with when the shooting starts, sir?" asks a U.S. Army sergeant, first class, as we creep toward the line of cash registers. He's a sharp-looking, well-built soldier with a close haircut and a 3rd Infantry Division patch on one shoulder and a small American flag on the other. His hands and neck are deeply tanned, as is his face, except where his sunglasses have stopped the UV radiation, leaving him with the reverse raccoon look so common among real desert fighters. It's one of the ways you can tell the genuine warriors from the BS artists who talk about war and get their tans at swimming pools or the beach. "We don't know for sure yet," I reply, "but I'm told that my cameraman and I are going to be assigned to the Marine Air Wing." "Humph, the Air Wing?" he chides me with a smile. "I thought you used to be an infantryman." "I was, but we all go where we're sent," I answer, feeling a bit defensive about my assignment. "Well," he says, "I understand we're going to have a Fox correspondent with my battalion. I sure hope he knows what he's doing. I don't want to have to nursemaid some prima donna who can't find his way to the latrine." Then he adds, almost prophetically, "Once the shooting starts, I think we're going to be pretty busy." Operation Iraqi Freedom, Situation Report Number 3. Coalition Press Information Center, Hilton Hotel, Kuwait City, Kuwait. 10th of March, 2003. 0900 hours local. "It figures that the military would take the nicest hotel in the city," says a producer from NBC as we walk out of the 90-plus degree heat into the air-conditioned comfort of the Hilton. U.S. Central Command, known as CENTCOM, has taken over this spacious facility to use as a press center. It's also the place where we get our embedding assignments, countless hours of briefings, immunization shots, gas masks, and chemical protective suits. There is a general mill drill in front of the reception desk where members of the media are clamoring for any information that's being offered by the 4 public affairs officers behind the desk, 2 Army and 2 Air Force, who are being barraged with questions. Finally, a diminutive Navy lieutenant dressed in desert camouflage comes out of a room behind the desk. She looks at the chaos, steps up on a chair behind the counter, and shouts, "If you already have your press credentials, back away from the desk and line up." The milling stops. She continues, "If you are here for your shots, line up over there." Some of the crowd starts to move that way. "If you are here to draw your chemical protective equipment, move over here." More of the crowd heads in that direction. "If you don't know why you are here, or if you've come here to hassle us about your assignment, tough. Go away and come back tomorrow." As she steps down off the chair, she looks at one of her Air Force colleagues and says, for the benefit of all, "Don't take this crap. Tell them what you want them to do, and repeat it as often as necessary. These are reporters, not sheep. Sheep you can herd. Reporters are like cats. Ever tried herding cats?" The crowd in front of the desk melts away as the reporters, commentators, cameramen, producers, field techs, and assorted media types from 6 countries assemble, some grumbling, in their respective lines. Now that there is some order, it appears that there are about 200 to 250 of us. Since I need both to draw my chemical protective equipment and get my shots, I go to the shortest line, the one for the shots. We've all been told that getting the shots for anthrax and smallpox is optional, but the briefing is mandatory. A colonel in the U.S. Army Medical Corps, wearing eagles on the collar of his desert camouflage uniform, is waiting on the small stage as we file into the room. He introduces himself as Colonel Larry Godfrey, and he begins by reminding us once again that being inoculated against the diseases Saddam Hussein is thought to have in his arsenal is purely voluntary. A very detailed exposition on each disease follows. It goes on for 15 or 20 minutes and contains all kinds of dry data on mortality rates, from the diseases as well as the drugs created to prevent them. I look around the room and notice that two or three of my colleagues are taking notes, and I assume that they must be correspondents for Scientific American or the AMA Journal. Most of us are simply sitting mutely, barely paying attention, as the colonel wraps up his presentation with, "So, if you have decided to receive the shots, you must write a check to Treasurer of the United States for $109 and complete the release of liability form." Colonel Godfrey concludes his presentation by asking if there are any questions. Of course there are. No room full of reporters can resist an invitation like that. They pepper him with queries about Gulf War syndrome. How many members of the armed forces have been court-martialed for refusing to get the shots? And what makes him think Saddam has these kinds of bugs in his arsenal? When the Q&A is over, an army medic appears with a pile of forms and says, "Everybody who's getting the shots, please raise your hand." Nobody moves. Instead, there is a lot of head shaking and quiet grumbling, comments like, "I'm not crazy," and "if it's safe, why do we have to sign a release form?" can be heard as the masters of the media start gathering their belongings, preparing to move outside for the lecture on chemical protective equipment. As they shuffle toward the door, Colonel Godfrey says from the stage, "Thank you for your attention. On your way out, you may want to look at this." A sequence of horrific photographs appears on the screen, people in the final stages of death from smallpox and anthrax. As the terrible images flash, there is a sudden stillness in the room. A voice says, "Oh my God." Suddenly, there is a rush to get the release of liability forms. I already have mine, so I'm the first in line. Anthrax in one arm, smallpox in the other. As it turns out, the reporters create a very long line after all. After getting through the shot line, we are escorted outside, where we form a line beside several long tables, behind which are seated a half dozen Army NCOs. One of the potentates of the press gripes, "I feel like I'm in kindergarten again." Without missing a beat, an Army non-com replies, "In kindergarten, the children do what they're told." We're all measured and fitted for chemical protective suits and gas masks. After the equipment is issued, everyone is taken to the tennis courts, where Army and Marine chemical and biological warfare specialists demonstrate how the equipment is worn and then drill everyone on how to put it all on in less than 10 seconds. In the aftermath of the anthrax and smallpox photos, no one is laughing. Chapter 2. SITZKRIEG. Operation Iraqi Freedom, Situation Report Number 4. Tactical Assembly Area, TAA, Ripper, Kuwait. Tuesday, 11th of March, 2003. 1300 hours, local. TAA Ripper is a dusty, dun-colored tent camp parked on a barren, flat, wind-blown desert plain, lacking both vegetation and recognizable terrain features. It is scorching hot, and the heat rises in waves off the desert floor. Behind every moving tank, armored vehicle, or truck, a plume of talcum-like dust rises and hangs in the air. Without a GPS receiver, it's impossible to know where you are or where you are going. Canvas cities like this one are spread all over the desert in northern Kuwait, up close and personal to the Iraqi border, as a Marine gunny puts it. Each one of these tactical assembly areas is home away from home for a U.S. or British ground combat unit. From the air, they all look about the same, row upon row of large tents surrounded by a 10-foot-high wall of earth topped with razor wire. This one is the temporary home of the fabled 7th Marine Regiment, one of the three regimental combat teams in the 1st Marine Expeditionary Division, the major ground component of the 1st Marine Expeditionary Force, known simply as IMEF. The entrance to TAA Ripper reminds me of the cavalry outposts in the Old West. Only instead of a log-walled fort, it's a sandbagged watchtower and a Marine manning an FNM 240G light machine gun who yells, "Halt!" Griff Jenkins, Adam Housley from the Fox News Channel Bureau in Kuwait City, and I disembarked from the air-conditioned comfort of our GMC Suburban to stand in the blazing sun while a team of Marine MPs examines the big SUV inside and out. Since the beginning of the year, Marines have been killed over here by terrorists, so these guys aren't taking any chances. The inspection of the vehicle complete, we're waved inside the compound and directed to the regimental command post. As we disembark again, a rifle company of Marines shuffles past, weapons slung over their shoulders, the sweat showing on the sleeves and trousers of their desert camouflage uniforms. They all have gas masks on their hips and bulky chemical protective suits in rucksacks. Web belts and carrying harnesses are crammed with canteens and canvas pouches for transporting the tools of war, magazines, grenades, ammunition, first aid kits, and radios. Their flak jackets and helmets are covered with grime, and dust swirls in the dead air as they pass. It occurs to me that the anti-war activists in Hollywood and the striped pants bureaucrats at the United Nations who have succeeded in delaying the inevitable ought to see them. Most of the Marines at TAA Ripper have been here for 2 months or more, having left California, either Camp Pendleton or the Marines' sprawling desert training base in 29 Palms, back in January. They are blissfully unaware of the political machinations of the United Nations that have held them in this dusty desert limbo for more than a month, poised like a diver prepared for a plunge at the end of the board. Few seem to be aware of the protests by the Blame America First crowd in San Francisco and on the streets of many European cities. They do know that the French have wimped out once again, and they are quick to remind any journalist who will listen that it's okay, because, as one Marine put it, the French have always been there when they needed us. In front of a nearby tent is a small crimson banner on a silver-tipped staff. Gold letters stitched onto the fabric read, Company L, 3rd Battalion, 7th Marines. I enter the relative darkness of the tent, and it's like a furnace. As my eyes adjust to the gloom, I spot, a few feet inside the entrance, a Marine, head down on a field desk, clearly asleep. Behind him, on a plywood shelf, are two radio sets, the coiled handset cords looping down into the sand. Beside the sleeping Marine, open on the field desk, is a yellow, dog-eared edition of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, dated February 6, 2003. Mail from home takes almost 3 weeks to get here, and any newspapers enclosed in a care package circulate through a 13-man squad, then around the rest of a 45-man platoon, until the paper is worn thin and the print is barely legible. This newspaper had clearly made the circuit. The lead story is all about the dramatic speech Secretary of State Colin Powell had made the day before at the United Nations, laying out the case for going after Saddam Hussein. The story is complete with satellite photos, diagrams of chemical weapons facilities, and transcribed intercepts of Iraqi communications. Next to one such translated conversation between two Iraqi officers, some Marine wag had written in ballpoint pen, "These guys talk too much." I decide not to awaken the sleeping Marine and proceed back outside, to be accosted by a crowd of Marines who had been on the way back to their billets from the mess tent when they spotted our civilian vehicle. They have surrounded Jenkins and Housley and are peppering the pair with questions such as, "What's happening back in the States?" This goes on for several minutes until a gunnery sergeant comes along and shoos the Marines off with a growled, "Go clean your weapons" type of command. The Marines scatter, and as soon as they are out of earshot, he tells the three of us that Colonel Steve Hummer, the regimental commander, is down at Commando, the 1st Marine Division CP command post, for a briefing. The gunnery sergeant adds he won't be back before nightfall. Since we have to be back in Kuwait City before dark, in lieu of an interview with the regimental commander, we accept his offer of some chow and walk to the mess tent. On the way, he answers our questions and describes their situation, though he is careful to say nothing about their mission. Most of the troops are billeted in frame tents holding 20 to 25 Marines, roughly half a platoon. The plywood floors, 2x4 support frames, and canvas have been erected by a U.S. military contractor. Contractors have also poured concrete pads for generators, maintenance space, communications equipment, and other heavy equipment, and installed some utilities. The rest of what you see here, the gunny continues, we brought in with us when we came from the States, or we offloaded it from the MPS. MPS is Marine vernacular for the maritime prepositioning ships, the large roll-on, roll-off vessels full of military equipment, weapons, and ammunition that are strategically placed to expedite the deployment of U.S. military units. 5 such ships were dispatched from their Indian Ocean base at Diego Garcia to Kuwait back in January. This MPS offload was a lot easier than during the first Gulf War because of all the contract stuff, says the gunnery sergeant, pointing around the area, and he looks at me, knowing he's baited the hook. Okay, I'll bite. What contract stuff? I reply. The construction and logistics contractors, Colonel, the gunny answers. The civilian outfits that put all this stuff up. They have been working on these base camps out here in the desert for more than a year. This stuff didn't just all happen overnight. Some very smart people started planning for this gunfight in the desert a long time before we got our pre-deployment orders back in December. As we approach the mess tent, an enormous green scoop loader with a CB logo grinds past us and dumps a bucket load of sand atop a prefabricated concrete shelter. Navy Construction Battalion and Marine Engineer personnel, wearing hard hats instead of helmets, are constructing these bunkers throughout the camp. The gunny gestures toward the structure being buried beneath the sand and says, "This camp is closest to the border, so we're adding a few more bunkers just in case Saddam hits us before we hit him." We enter the mess tent and join a long line of Marines. The food service is also a contract operation, run by a Kuwaiti contractor. The Marines are being served by locals from a steam line on plastic trays, rather than the old metal mess kits that had been in use when I retired. The food isn't great, but it's palatable, and there is salad, fresh fruit, and ice to put in the drinks. All things that can't be found in an MRE, the meal ready-to-eat combat rations. Any concerns about locals preparing and serving the food and coming and going around the base? I ask the gunny. He pauses to reflect a moment, then says, "Some, I suppose. But the contractor has been vetted, all the workers are too, by the Kuwaiti Security Service. They are escorted on and off the base and closely supervised while they're here. Most of them are from Bangladesh or the Philippines. I guess the risk is worth it, because for every one of them back here fixing food, it releases one of our own. That means we have another shooter in a combat unit." We finish our meal and go back outside. A show-and-tell has been arranged for 15 to 20 foreign journalists. The goal, I'm told, is to familiarize these overseas reporters with Marine Corps weapons, equipment, and organization. Because Fox News Channel isn't part of the contingent, we're not allowed to bring any cameras. Apparently, the press corps covering the war doesn't want to be covered itself, so I just tag along. It's quickly evident that these masters of the overseas media are less interested in the weapons on display than they are in what the Marines who use them have to say. They swirl around the young troopers like sharks looking for prey. Questions fly about everything from the weather to opinions on the UN, anti-war protests, and their commander-in-chief, and how long they have been here waiting for the war to start. In response, the Marines, most of them corporals and sergeants, are brutally frank. Despite the delay in getting done what they came here to do, these young warriors revere their commander-in-chief. And whether the nice folks at the UN or the critics in Europe and anti-war activists in the United States like it or not, these Marines have a refreshing certainty about their mission, Saddam Hussein, and the need to evict him from Iraq. This isn't because they are naive or poor, uneducated minorities, as some liberal politicians have alleged in advocating a reinstitution of conscription. Advocates of a draft say that it's necessary to equalize the pool of conscripts so that white upper and middle class Americans are made to serve as well as those from lower economic groups and minority groups. Yet these all-volunteer troops are already predominantly white, middle-income Americans, and they are all high school graduates. Minorities are, if anything, underrepresented in these units. The mission focus of these young Americans in uniform doesn't stem from being brainwashed by their superiors, and not because these Marines are bloodthirsty, as some of these foreign journalists seem to believe. In fact, none of the soldiers, sailors, airmen, or Marines with whom I have spoken over the last several days has told me that they are over here itching for a fight. What has apparently been missed by many of the media elites here, covering the preparations for a fight in the Iraqi desert, is the fact that no one who has ever really been to a war ever really wants to go to another one. And a remarkable percentage of these young men already have combat experience. One commander I spoke with estimated that more than half his officers and senior non-commissioned officers have served under fire before, in the first Gulf War, the Balkans, or Afghanistan, and in some cases, all three. They know better than any correspondent, reporter, or politician the true nature of war. That it is the most terrible of human endeavors. Yet, precisely because so many of them have so much combat experience, they are anxious to get on with the task at hand. They know that the sooner it gets started, the sooner it will be over. Many of them express frustration that what was supposed to be a blitzkrieg has become a sitzkrieg. One young NCO says, "We're the best there is, but this is going to be the most telegraphed punch in military history." And that's not the only problem with further delay. A recon Marine, one of those whose job it is to penetrate deep inside enemy territory to scout out routes, objectives, and enemy targets to be hit, says, "We do our best work under conditions of marginal visibility. We don't like to operate when the moon is like a big light bulb in the night sky." I watch as the foreign press reporters scribble furiously while talking to an NBC NCO, one of those responsible for ensuring that the Marines survive an attack by weapons of mass destruction. The NBC isn't the network. It stands for nuclear, biological, and chemical. His comments get their attention. "The longer we wait, the more time Saddam has to plot and carry out a chemical, biological, or nuclear attack, and the hotter it's going to be wearing those protective suits and masks." As the reporters head back to their vans, I ask a Marine staff sergeant how he thinks it went. He shrugs and replies, "They will probably say we were whining and complaining, but what the troops were..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.